If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to John chapter 20. This is part two of a series I've been doing on resurrection. Again, if you don't have a communion cup, we want you to have one because at the end of the service, we're going to take one. So if you just wave your hand or somebody can see you right now, they're going to give you one. Good deal. Come here, buddy. I need one. All right. John chapter 20. Tomorrow night, if you have your Passover ticket, that'll be at the college at 6 p.m. It's going to be good stuff. If you don't have a ticket, there's a small chance that a miracle could happen and somebody would call and say that you're not going to be able to make it and you could go, so get your name on a waiting list. How many of you are going home and grandma or mom have cooked a big supper for lunch? How many of you? Raise your hand. I can remember growing up next to my grandma, and it was ham and turkey and roast and granny green beans, and all that cream corn, mashed potatoes and gravy. Praise God. You know what? Jesus loves you. He rose from the dead. Let's go home and eat. Amen. I'm kidding. That's a joke. But my wife has cooked a big lunch this afternoon, and we're going to get fatter in the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. And my daughter made me my very own lemon pie. Praise God. If you have your Bibles, you're in John 20. We're going to start in verse 19. I told you last week that this is a series on resurrection, and what had happened is Mary comes to the tomb and come to find out on Sunday morning, around 2,000 years ago, Mary comes to a tomb on a Sunday morning just like we're meeting today, and guess what? Jesus isn't there. She goes and gets Peter and John, and Peter and John have a race to the tomb. John wins, and I preached to you about running like John. I preached to you about having the courage to go into the tomb and search for Jesus like Peter, who was breaking the law by even attempting to do that. And have the love of Mary, who was there before anybody else and who was there after everybody else had gone. She loved Jesus. And as we continue this story, that the events that immediately follow the resurrection, the Bible says in verse 19 that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Now, you can imagine their fear as they just watched their beloved Jesus go through the scourging and the crucifixion, and it's in their minds that if they get caught, because now Jesus' body is missing, and the first thing that the Jewish leaders are going to do is accuse them of stealing his body, correct? And in their mind, they're thinking what they did to him, they're going to do to us. So they're hiding from the Jewish leaders. And suddenly, imagine these 12 people, maybe 15 or 20 others not named, and imagine they're sitting there in a small room, and all of a sudden, the Bible says, suddenly Jesus was standing there among them. Now, it's one thing on Resurrection Sunday to believe in that a man who was dead is now alive. This is not some type of fairy tale. This really happened. This is not a make-believe story. This really happened. And so if you can believe that a man who was dead is now living, you can also believe that a man who was absent has all of a sudden appeared. And there he is in the midst of these men, and they were startled. Now, maybe you wouldn't be. Maybe you'd just be like, oh, well, hi. Chester would lose bodily function. If a man who I knew to be dead all of a sudden appeared in my midst standing there, and not only is he alive, but he just shows up. That's freaky. So the logical thing Jesus says is, peace be with you. Right? Peace. Let me try to make this. It's funny because, you know, I'm not one of those very couthful dads. I'm one of those dads that'll put pantyhose on my head and hide behind the door at nighttime and just call their name, Chad. And when they come running around and it's already kind of creepy, I'm just jumping, rah, right? And then they just scream and cry, and I'm like, score. Jesus could have done, he could have like sent an angel and said, hey guys, Jesus, he's resurrected from the dead. He's going to be coming through the doorway any moment now. So y'all just watch and pray, okay? He could have knocked on the door. He could have done anything, but you have men who are scared to death in a room and he decides to do the scariest thing he can think of. I love Jesus. Amen? Just bam! I mean, David Blaine ain't got nothing, amen, on Jesus. He's just like, boom! And he says, by the way, peace be with you. He's sarcastic. He's hilarious. Amen? Verse 20. As he spoke, he showed them the wounds in his hands and in his side, and they were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. Again, he said, peace be with you. As a father has sent me, so I am sending you. In verse 22, the Bible says, he gets down in their face, and he breathed on them, and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. So what just happened right there? He breathed on them. Up until the moment that Jesus died, was buried, and up until the moment that he resurrected, you are talking about the Old Testament. The New Testament did not start with the birth of Jesus. The New Testament started with the rebirth of Jesus, when he was born from the grave to new life again. And in that moment, the disciples received the breath of God, and for the first time, they were truly born again. See, they couldn't be born again while Jesus was still walking on the earth because Jesus had not yet atoned for sin. He had not yet paid the penalty for our sin. And so in that moment, Jesus breathes on them and they receive the Spirit, the new birth, being born again. Now you got to go back and think about this because this is not the first time this has happened. If you take your Bible, that word breathe there is emphyseo. It means literally to blow or breathe upon. Now the interesting word emphyseo, the thing about it is it's the only time this word is used in the entire New Testament. One time right here to breathe on them. Now, if you take the Septuagint is the Greek translation of the first five books of the Bible. And if you go to Genesis chapter 2:7, throw that up there for me, brother. The Lord God formed man. His name is Adam. He is Adam, man. The dust of the ground, he formed this clay figurine and he emphyseoed the breath of life into the man's nostrils, and the man became a living person. See, God had formed this thing out of the dust of the ground, and he had put its eye sockets in, and he had molded ears, and he had strung hair, and he had chiseled pecs like, never mind, okay? And he had made this handsome man named Adam. But all Adam was a figure. And all he was a body who stood there, whose eyes were empty, and whose breath didn't hold anything but air. But when God came down and he took the life that was in him and he breathed it on a clay figure, and man became a living soul. That word living there is the word chai, spelled C-H-A-Y. They don't say ch in Hebrew, it ka. You gotta spit it up, right? It's chai. And so chai, everybody say chai. It means this, live and life. The clay figure is standing there, and he emphyseo chai into him, life. If you look at that word life, the funny thing about it, if you was here last week and you heard my sermon, it's translated 197 times as life, translated 145 times as live. It's translated 31 times as alive. It's translated 6 times as living thing. It's translated 7 times as running. Did y'all forget my sermon last week? Yeah, you did, didn't you? Running. And I thought, well, that's interesting. And I looked it up, and all 7 times in the Old Testament, that word kai is translated running. It's talking about running water. And it's every time in the context that they would pour running water over the sacrifice for sin. And Jesus in John chapter 7 shows up on the scene, and he says, on the last day of the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and shouted to the crowds, anyone who is thirsty, come to me. For if anyone believes in me, he may come and drink. For the scriptures declare that rivers of running or kai water will flow from here. Oh, y'all aren't getting it, are you? Verse 39, when he said living water or kai water or the running water, he was speaking of the Spirit. Now, if we go back to John chapter 20, just hold that verse, I'll tell everybody. If you go back to John chapter 20, the Bible says in verse 22, he breathed on them. He breathed on them. We know when he breathed on them life. And he said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. This is not all you Pentecostal friends of mine and charismatic friends of mine. This is not the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Say amen. This is salvation. Okay? Okay? He said, receive the Spirit. If you go here, it says, when he said living water, he was speaking of the Spirit who would be given to everyone believing in him. But the Spirit had yet not been given. Why? Because Jesus had not yet ascended. Are you with me? And so here's the picture. Jesus is saying, there's coming a day when if the Spirit comes, that I will be able to breathe my life. After I'm resurrected, I will be able to breathe my life and give you the Spirit that you are no longer after the pattern of the clay man. But you become after the pattern of the last Adam, the living, life-giving man. So he says in 2 Corinthians, Paul says, 5:16, for we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. Listen, at one time we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. And listen, think about this. Let's take the disciples in that verse. At one time the disciples thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. They walked with him on this earth, and they believed that he was God, right? Peter says to Jesus, you are the Son of the living God. But all they knew of him was that he was human. Are y'all going to help me or not? I done sidetracked you with that ham that you're thinking about right now, ain't you? When I said granny green beans, I just lost you right there. So here's Jesus, and he says to them, Peter, who am I? Jesus says, you're the Son of the living God. And they declared that he was God, the Son of the God, but they only knew him as human. And it rocked their world when they watched the human one on the cross dying, for they had no idea that would ever happen. And his humanity was never more as real as when they were watching it be torn apart. And so here, Jesus shows up on Sunday night after they are trying to reconcile in their minds that the man in the grave is no longer there. And he breathes on them. And for a second, the humanity of Jesus becomes in question, as if they are having to reconcile in their mind that the human one has superimposed human limitations of death, and he is now a living dead man. And so at one time they thought him merely as a man. how differently they know him now. What's the difference? Because the dead man has become the resurrected man. And verse 18 says this, or verse 17, this means that anyone who belonged to Christ has become a new person. And the old Kai, the old life has gone. There's a new Kai. And it has begun because just like Jesus, the old thing has been nailed to the cross and buried, but we have been resurrected with Christ into a new Kai. Amen. And you go on to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, Paul tells us this. The scriptures tell us the first man, Adam, became a living person. When? Genesis 2:7. There he is, that clay creature standing there. God comes down. I mean, if there's something I would have loved to have seen, I'd love to have been an ant on the ground watching that day as this clay thing stands there and God himself breathes on him. And he comes alive. And the thing about it, the angels, is the book by Gene Edwards I love, that he writes out this story, and he talks about how the angels who were standing there, listen, who were standing there must have saw the first time Adam breathed, and they didn't recognize that he looked like God from a physical appearance. They recognized that he looked like God because the same spirit that was in God was now in man. You see, when you were created, you weren't created in the physical image of God. You were created in the spiritual image of God. And it's the spirit in you, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. It's the spirit in you that all creation sees that points what you are to God. Because, honey, you're beautiful, but you don't look like him physically. It's the living spirit of God inside of you that said, now that's Christ. The scripture tells us the first man, Adam, became a living person. The Kai. He became Kai, life. He became running water as a running man. But the last Adam, now, you ever heard of anybody refer to Jesus as a second Adam? Don't do that. There's a first and there's a last. The first Adam was the first Adam. The last Adam is the last Adam. There is no second Adam because there's never going to be a third Adam. He is the last Adam because he has finished it on the cross. The last Adam, that is Christ. I love this. The last Adam, the first Adam received life. The last Adam, because he was resurrected, has the authority and the power to become a life-giving spirit. Whereas the first Adam could only receive life, the last Adam, because of the resurrection, now has the authority to be the life-giving, full embodied man. So verse 46 says, what comes first in the natural body, the spiritual comes later. Verse 47 says, Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. Verse 48, earthly people are like earthly man, and heavenly people are like heavenly man. Just as we are now like the earthly man, we will someday be like heaven. Now stop. That translation, we will someday, is wrong. It literally should be translated as, I should use my notes. Here we go. Let us also be. We will someday, can I just rock your world for a second? I'm about to give an altar call here in a little bit and ask anybody that wants to, if you want to come and be saved. You know what my goal is? All across pulpits in this country right now, people are going to say this statement. If you died right now, do you know where you'd go? Hell or heaven? Do you know that my goal absolutely right now is not to get you to go to heaven? I don't want you to go to hell either. Don't think that. You don't want to go to heaven? No. We will someday is a bad translation. Let us be. The reason you get saved is not to go to heaven. If all you want to do is go to heaven, then you just brought a stamp to get out of hell. It's not Monopoly's get out of jail free card. I want to go to heaven. I will be reunited with my friends and loved ones there. Amen. That is a hope that Paul says we have as a byproduct of being saved. But the goal of salvation is not heaven. The goal of salvation is Kai. Notice Adam. Adam is a clay thing. Without life in him, he is no different than all of other creation. But as soon as life is breathed into him, he becomes a living soul, which separates him from all of creation. And God doesn't take the man off the earth to come be united with him in heaven. No, God goes to where he is to live with him in a garden on the earth. The same is true that when Jesus was resurrected, he didn't just want you to live your 60 more years so that one day you could might go to heaven. He had a plan for those 60 years for him to fellowship with you on the earth through the garden that's called the Spirit. And once more, we will go to heaven after we're raptured or after we're died, but we don't stay in heaven because God's ultimate plan is for the city, the New Jerusalem, to come to earth because it has never been God's will for you just to escape hell. It was always his will for him to have a relationship with his humanity, him to have a relationship with you. He wants to give you life. At that point that Adam was created, he was created a being, but he was only living and could have fellowship after he was breathed upon. So my question to you is not when 60 years when you die will you go to heaven. My question is when you leave this room tomorrow, will you be able to have communion with Christ, because you now have the same Chi living spirit that was in Christ living in you. See, I'm not trying to get you to go to heaven. I'm trying to get you to live for the very first time. Romans 8 says, so now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. 8:2 says, because you belong to him, the power of the Chi-giving spirit has freed you from the power of a clay body that would experience a natural death. See, it's my personal opinion, ladies and gentlemen. Forgive me on Easter Sunday for unbuttoning my collar, but I'm feeling it now. It's my personal opinion that you as the believer, that just before you breathe your very last breath on that deathbed or whatever circumstance, that your spirit is sucked out of your body and you never experience the totality of dying, because dying has been nailed to a cross and he experienced dying so that you could experience life forever and more abundantly. Amen. So whereas your natural body may degrade, your spirit, the thing that is really you, is going to live forever. Because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own son. In a body, he sent his own son, just like Adam, like the body that you have. This is not going to be popular. Raise your hand if you're a child of God. Everybody's like, we're good. We're going to get that settled here in a little bit, okay? No. If you're not saved, may I help you? And I'm not being some kind of fundamentalist crazy person. You're not a child of God. As a matter of fact, the Bible says if you're not saved, you're not born again, you are at intimacy with God. You are an enemy of God. Not my words, the scripture. This idea that everybody in the world is a child of God is false. Thus, the reason you have to be born again. But the moment his face comes down and breathes on you, and you receive the Holy Spirit for the first time, you are truly alive. And in that instance, you are a child of the living God. God sent his own son in the body like the bodies that we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin. How did that happen? 2,000 years ago, a man named Jesus Christ was born of a virgin named Mary. He lived a sinless life. He did not sin. 33 and a half years he was on this earth. And he was given over to suffering by scourge. He was given over to death by the cross. They took his body off that cross and put him in a tomb. And 3 days later, he rose from the grave. Now, the thing about my Jesus is that every other religion in the world, there is someone who is deemed that you should worship. But all those worshiped entities, those men who lived in the past, declared themselves as God, they're all dead. But the one thing that separates the dead God from the other God, Jesus, is that he's not dead. He's living. Now, another religion may ask you to come give your life and blow yourself up for faith in the hope that you might one day go to paradise. Amen? But I'm telling you that Jesus didn't give you a hope for a future. He did in heaven, but he's living because he wants more than a hope for a future. He wants a life today. Literally, in about 45 minutes, there's people in this room that will be there for the first time living. And the hope is not something to come. The hope is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He says in verse 9, you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. Remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him at all. Verse 10, Christ lives within you, so even your body will die because of sin. The Spirit gives you chi because you have been made right with God. Verse 11, this is the one I want to get to. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead, the only reason we're gathered here today, the resurrection of Jesus, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will give life to your pre-breathed body. You are like, there's many of you in this room that you are like Adam, who had been formed out of the dust of the earth, and you've been walking around in some kind of robotic mode all your life. You might be 15, you might be 75 today, but you've been walking around as a shell of a person your entire life. And today, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead wants to come right up to your face. And for the very first time, you're going to be living. Ladies and gentlemen, we're celebrating this one fact today. Let me get this straight. Don't you walk out of here and say, Chester, say, it ain't a big deal that we're going to heaven. My grandfather's up there. I want to see him real bad. And there's a fullness of Jesus I have not yet obtained, but I can only obtain when I get to heaven. I want that real bad. But I'm telling you, right now, today, you can live in an arena of faith by the Spirit that you've never known was possible if you'll just say yes and let him breathe life into you. Amen? So stand up on your feet. I want you to close your eyes. I want you to bow your head. I want to ask you a real simple question this morning. The question is not, if you died right now, do you know where you go? The question is different this Sunday. My question to you is, are you alive? I'm not talking about your physical being. I'm not talking about your dust. But are you alive? There's hope in this room that for somebody who feels like that your life is pointless and that you're just stuck in circles and that you're just living a useless existence, it's because maybe you've never truly lived yet. Jesus, just like for his disciples in that room, he wants to breathe on you. And he wants to deposit something inside of you that makes you come alive like you've never known living. I'm not talking about merely happiness, and I'm not talking about merely pleasure. I'm talking about that when you lay your head on your pillow at night, that you know that you exist for a reason. That when you open your eyes in the morning, that you know that you have purpose. That you're living not to do all the things on earth we do, but you're living because there was someone who was so madly in love with you that he sent his only son to die on the cross because he wanted a relationship with you. Not the best version of you on Facebook, not the best idea of what you can become, but in your filth and in your nastiness and all the crud that you have on your life right now, he was madly in love with you. And he sent his son that even yet while we were sinners, he loved you so much that he sent his son to die for you to give you life. So my question today is, if you're in this room and you've never said yes to Jesus, I'm not talking about saying yes to heaven. I'm saying if you've never said yes to Jesus, if you're in this room and you've never said yes to Jesus and you want to live for the very first time, Jesus is just waiting to just breathe on you. And he wants to live inside of you. He wants to fellowship with you and he wants to be one with you. So all across this room, if you've never given your life to Jesus and you want to do that for the first time, you want to live for the first time, I'm asking you to be brave this morning. And I'm asking you to get out of your seat and come to the front, and I just want to pray for you right now. Come on, that's you. I want you to get out of your seat right now and come to the front. Come on.